Hello everyone, today we are looking into the third episode of Statistical Psychology and dealing with data representation. Turn on your captions to follow along and let's get started. So we have seen that data refers to numerical facts describing a particular situation. However, there is a lot of confusion as to what is the difference between organization, classification, and tabulation of data. Organization means to arrange the data in a way that makes it meaningful and understandable, because data on its own is of little use. Classification is a type of organization in which data is divided into several classes. Tabulation is the depiction of classified data in the form of tables for a concise and simplistic overview. Hence, we tabulate the data after we have organized it, or we can say after we have classified it in this particular case. It's always good to classify your data. There are clear-cut categories. They are mutually exclusive and hence don't overlap with each other and don't cause confusions. It's also good because similar data entries get grouped together. If the data set represents consumables people take in during the summer season, vanilla ice cream and chocolate ice cream may fall in the same group, while orange and mango juice occupy another. This is me going out of a way a bit, but geographical classification divides categories on the basis of area and landscape. We have chronological classification doing so on the basis of time. Qualitative does so on the basis of characteristics and qualities of data items, whereas quantitative classification divides categories on the basis of magnitude of each data item or each data point. Now, these are the official definitions of tabulation and frequency distribution. If you want, you can pause the video here and read them yourself. The table on the right is a table we have all seen before, and that's what we are about to look at. But before that, let's see different types of frequency distributions. So the first type of frequency distribution is an individual observation table. It basically shows you a list of observations, each occurring a single time in our data set. For example, there is only one case of roll number 2 getting 57 marks. It intuitively does not even feel like a frequency distribution table at times. The second one is grouped/ungrouped frequency distribution, which shows you the number of times a single data point has been repeated. For example, how many kids got 6 marks in a class test? The table will tell you that the number is 4, hence the frequency of each mark is recorded. We can say that the frequency of each data point is mentioned. The third form is the one we will be dealing with in detail, the continuous frequency distribution. Data points are summarized into classes and these classes have their frequency mentioned alongside them. This makes the entire table making process a lot easier. Now, there are different ways of determining the variables of a table. I'm going to stick to the ones which I find the most reliable. In a continuous frequency distribution, n is the number of value or data points in a data set. Range is basically the highest data point minus the lowest data point of the data set. In the given data set, we see that 89 is the highest data point, 2 is the lowest, and hence the range is 89 minus 2, which is equal to 87. The lower and upper limits of the class are intuitive. They denote the start and end of a data class. Coming to how many classes you should have, a good way to do that is to take the square root of n. Our data set has 15 values and hence the square root of 15 lies between 3 and 4. So we will go with 4 here. Choose the higher value out of the two. If n would have been a perfect square, then we would have taken the value of its square root as the number of classes. For example, if n would have been 25, the number of classes would have been 5. The class interval is depicted by a range being divided by the number of classes. The range is 87, and when it is divided by 4, which is the number of classes we are going for, we get 21.8. Now we are going to round this up to 22. Now remember, this is important. Even if the answer would have been 21.2 or 21.4, we still would have rounded it up to 22. That's because we have to round up and not round off. In this case, if we decide to round off, then according to the formula, we will end up having more classes than the desired number, and this will threaten the continuity of our table. Now, let's make a grouped frequency distribution table. Have a look at the data set. It has 32 values, hence n is equal to 32. The range is the highest data point, which is 74, minus the lowest data point, which is 48, and hence the range is 26. The lower value of the first class is generally taken to be the lowest data point or lower than that. That's intuitive, because if you choose the lower limit to be higher than the lowest value, then where on earth are you going to take the lowest value? So we are going to take 48 to be the lower limit of our first class. Number of classes will be determined by the square root of n, which means the square root of 32, and hence it will lie between 5 and 6. As usual, we are going to pick 6 as the desired number of classes. I, or class width, will be range divided by the desired number of classes, which means 26 divided by 6. This will give us 4.3, which we will round up to 5. Notice how we have rounded up the number and not rounded it off. Had we rounded it off, it would have been 4. Now we have all the necessary information. We know that the lower limit of our first class, and if we keep adding the class width to each subsequent lower limit, we will keep getting the lower limit of the next class. Hence the lower limit turns out to be 48, 53, 58, and so on. Intuitively, you can define the upper limits of each class as 52, 57, 62, and so on till 77. If someone asks you about boundary limits, all you have to do is to subtract 0.5 from the lower limit of each class and add 0.5 to the upper limit of each class. The official procedure is a lot more complex, detailing what you have to do when you have decimals in your data sets, but we won't be needing that just yet. Go back and tally the number of data points that fall within each class, and you have the frequencies ready as well. That's all, folks. Hope you enjoyed this video. Like, comment, share, and subscribe if you like what I'm doing. Stay tuned for the next one. Peace.